Nirvana, Alice in Chains, Soundgarden, and Mudhoney have all emerged from the musical hotbed of Seattle, Washington. Also rising from the Seattle scene is Pearl Jam, whose music appeals to both metal fans, college DJs, and at the same time echoing 70s rock.
A lot of music from the 70s, you know, stuff like Led Zeppelin and Elton John and all those bad 70s radio hits that we all listen to.
Pearl Jam was born from the ashes of Seattle band Mother Love Bone. After that group's lead singer, Andy Wood, died in 1990, longtime friends and ex-Green River bandmates Stone Gossard and Jeff Ament regrouped and in early 1991 formed Pearl Jam with ex-Bad Radio member Eddie Vedder.
Andy gave us a tape with a couple of songs that he'd done with his other band, Bad Radio, and he ended up singing over, like, we had an instrumental tape with like 8 or 9 songs, and he ended up singing over 3 of them, and he came up and we hung out for like 7 or 8 days and had an amazing time. I mean, just played music all the time and just like fell in love with music again, like in a big way. And it's pretty much... We really wanted to find somebody that was completely different, you know, than Andy too, and I think...
Definitely did.
Eddie was perfect. We were blown away by how... I'm still blown away in a lot of ways.
We basically made the record, I guess it was 3 or 4 months after becoming a band, so I think it's a very raw and very young sounding record, which is exactly where we were at that time. I think that's kind of how this band wants to operate, letting some of the rough edges show and just being honest with where we're at musically.
1, 2, 3. What in this world run into you, did in? Leave a message, at least I could learn your voice one last time. Daily mind feel this could be my time by your... Would you hit me? Would you hit me?
After completing a U.S. tour supporting the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Pearl Jam was thrust into the limelight and got their first taste of stardom after an appearance on MTV Unplugged.
I mean, we did a show like that in Zurich, Switzerland, and that's about the only show that we have to compare it to.
We walked in and the stage was way too small. Stage, you know, and we had just had a really bad night the night before in Milan, Italy.
Yeah.
Where it was just way too small and people were like killing themselves and we were going to kill each other on stage because we didn't want to compromise what we do, even though it was a small stage. So we saw Zurich and quick, get some smaller instruments, get some acoustic
like quiet
instruments. And then it was the next day somebody called and asked about MTV Unplugged. So we said, yeah, we can do that. I think it's one of the greatest half hours on TV. I mean, live music for a half an hour,
it doesn't happen. And you get to hear the songs like totally stripped down, like in their natural, you know, form. It's not, you're not being hidden behind bad PA sound or whatever. I mean, it's not loud. It's like the songs for what they are. It was cool.
a young man's room. She said,
newfound success, sales of Pearl Jam's debut album 10 went through the roof, and interest was renewed in Temple of the Dog, a tribute album they recorded a year earlier for the late Mother Love Bone singer Andy Wood, with two members of fellow Seattle band Soundgarden, including frontman Chris Cornell, Wood's best friend and roommate.
Well, I don't mind stealing bread from the mouths of
Decadence. It was right after Andy had died, and Chris had written a couple songs about Andy and played them for me and Jeff and said, you know, if you guys want to, you know, help get together and record these songs with you, it'd be great. And the songs were
amazing.
Were Say Hello to Heaven and Reach Down, and it was like, even the demo version that he did at his house was like totally
sickening.
I had a couple more songs, and Chris ended up writing, like, you know, four more songs on top of that, and we made the record for, I mean, 1/20th of what we normally make, you know, or what, you know, the average major label, you know, record is made for, and we made it in about, you know, probably a total of about 2.5 weeks. So I think in that sense, I think we're more proud of it than anything, because it was like no pressure, and we just went in and we just did it. And we didn't, like, think about it too much, and we left a lot of stuff really just kind of the way it was, and it's pretty jammy, and it's a record that, it's just a great record, I think.
At home, drawing pictures of mountaintops.
Meanwhile, Pearl Jam continued their nonstop touring in support of 10, quickly earning a reputation as one of the hottest live acts around. They also made a new video for the song Even Flow, and like Alive, it was performance-driven.
our videos have basically been just like documenting our live performance. So, and we really haven't, I don't think we're at the point yet where we want to start taking on making like, you know, mini movies or whatever. So,
I mean, that's what we're doing. We're playing live and we don't have any time to like sit around and think, oh, this would be cool, or let's put Eddie up in a tree, or let's have Jeff floating underwater playing his bass, you know. It's just kind of silly. We don't want to think about that stuff right now. We're playing live, and you know, I guess any videos are going to be like live.
The band Mother Love Bone have started their first ever European tour.
To play, to come over, we've never been able to play this country before, and to come here and to play in a little place and have people singing the words somewhere so far away from your home or where you wrote them, and actually feeling it the same way you did, it was, I don't know, I'll never forget it. It was really cool.
Pearl Jam's good fortune wouldn't last, however, when on the verge of completing their first European tour, exhaustion set in, and they headed back home to Seattle for a much-needed rest.
We've been on the road for over 10 months, and I think just being away from home and being on the road all the time, and if we weren't doing Lollapalooza, we probably wouldn't be touring anymore. We'd probably take a break, and we'd go back and make another record. But
it's one of those things, if it's not fun, the only reason why we're doing this is because we love to do it, you know. And if it ever turns into a job, it turns into a job on those days when you're, you know, you've been out for 10 months and the last thing in the world you feel like doing is going up on stage. And I mean, especially for Eddie too, because of his intensity of every performance. I mean, he's just like completely, you know, maniacal.
After a short break, Pearl Jam headed back on the road for 2 months of shows on Lollapalooza 2. They also made a new video for what was to become, whether they knew it or not, their biggest hit.
I don't want to tell what the song is about because a lot of these lyrics have been open to interpretation, and people have taken them, they've become part owners. And if I were to just explain literally what the song would be about, then that excludes them from being part of it.
At home, drawing pictures of mountaintops with him on top, lemon yellow sun, arms raised in a V, and the dead lay in pools of room.
Jeremy was Pearl Jam's first concept video, a concept they'd been leery of until hooking up with director Mark Pellington.
His sensibilities and his ideas and techniques, they seem like you'd be able to get a lot of information across in kind of an interesting style that is subtle and yet hard-hitting at the same time.
We did spend a lot of time on the videos as far as what's going on and stuff, but we didn't do that for the Video Music Awards.
No.
We did that for us representing our song and ourselves.
I don't have anything to complain about. I mean, our band's doing 10 times as well as I ever thought we would. We're getting to play shows almost every day. I mean, we're happy, you know. We have nothing to complain about.
So if you see us like in the crowd just hanging out, don't bug us and get all weird and scream or nothing in our face. It happened once already. That was the most embarrassing moment of my whole life. Don't scream.
We're just human.
I'm really glad to be in this band in the sense that
I mean, also, I'm so excited about our third record, our fourth record, because I can see that this is going to be a band that grows and continually trying to change and do new things. But, you know, it's just good to know that you're playing with people that you could see yourself playing with for a long time, because the musical communication is there, and hopefully if we maintain the human communication, everything will continue to move forward. So,
I didn't understand that last time.
Well, the musical communication, which is us playing in a room together.
I don't relate to you anymore.
It makes sense.
There was a time during that good old first record I really understood where you're coming from.
See, he's got me kind of riled already.